here's a second-order tensor. We saw in the previous episode it is constructed over two vector spaces, shown as blue and red. We also saw we can visualize it as a sphere with arrows. We can interpret this sphere as a kind of a map between the two spaces. Given a blue vector, we can feed it into the tensor and obtain a red vector. In this episode, we'll use it to represent electromagnetic fields. Let's start with some background. This is an electric field. Such a field is represented by a vector field. Each point in space has a vector defining the magnitude and direction of the field at that point. We're drawing only those on the XZ plane, where most of the action is going to be. For simplicity, this field is uniform, so all the vectors are the same. Say a particle enters this field. The force it will experience is equal to the particle's electric charge multiplied by the electric field. Throughout this video, we'll assume one unit of charge to simplify the discussion. So the force is simply equal to the electric field. It will cause acceleration in the Z direction. Let's simulate it. And this is a magnetic field. It is also represented by a vector field. Here, they're all pointing down along the Y axis. The formula for the force here is a bit more complicated and depends also on the particle's velocity. It is equal to the cross product of the velocity and the magnetic field. A particle with zero velocity will experience no force because a cross product with zero is zero. If the particle has a non-zero velocity, it will experience a force. The cross product of two vectors is a vector that is perpendicular to both of them, so the resulting magnetic force is always perpendicular to the velocity, causing a circular motion. With a larger velocity, we'll get a larger force. Now let's explore this relationship in more detail. Say we have a particle, and the magnetic field points straight down. The cross product formula determines for each possible velocity the resulting magnetic force. For example, if the particle moves to the right, it will be pulled backwards. If it moves forward, it will be pulled to the right. If it moves up, it will experience no force because the cross product of parallel vectors is zero. If it's close to moving up, it will experience a small force. We can represent this relationship using a tensor. It acts like a map, telling us for each velocity which magnetic force will act on the particle. Let's try, for example, a unit-sized velocity pointing in the X direction. The tensor tells us the particle will experience a force pulling it backwards. And if it moves in the Z direction, it is pulled to the right. And similarly for all other directions. Here are the components of this tensor. We saw in the previous episode how they are related to the map. The three rows define the three forces that lie on the axes. For example, the first row defines the force pulling back, and the second defines the zero force at the top. For an arbitrary direction, we take the components and compute a weighted sum or a linear combination of the three rows. We got the correct magnetic force here too. The reason this works is because our map is a linear map. Here's, for example, a nonlinear map. This is not a tensor and can't be represented by components in the way we've just seen. But our map is linear. Its linearity is expressed in another way. Say we take a larger velocity. This vector is twice the size of the previous example. It will be mapped to a force twice as large. So the tensor's map is defined everywhere, mapping every possible velocity to a force. Showing only the unit sphere is enough to get a good visual impression of how it behaves. Although sometimes it is useful to draw other parts of it, like this planar section. We'll return to it later. Now let's put this tensor to use in a simulation. Instead of a vector field and the cross product formula, we'll use our new method, a tensor field. Each point in space has a tensor. Say a particle enters this field, moving with some velocity. The tensor at its current point maps its velocity to a force. This is the force the particle will experience and its path will bend. At each point it arrives, the tensor at that point again maps its velocity to a force, and so on. Here's the same simulation, except now we'll add an upward component to the initial velocity. it runs in circles on the XZ plane while moving up. Now let's try a magnetic field vector pointing in an arbitrary direction. Here's the tensor representing it. As before, the three rows of the matrix represent the three forces that lie on the axes. The first row is associated with a unit size velocity in the x direction, or 1, 0, 0. The row contains the force mapped to this velocity, which is the cross product of 1, 0, 0 and b. The result has a distinctive pattern. 0, then two components of b flipped, and one of them negated. The other rows have similar patterns. So we got the components of B scattered around our matrix in a particular way. Also, the matrix is antisymmetric. The diagonal is 0, and the part below the diagonal is the negative of the upper part. Such matrices always give us this vortex look. Here are a few more examples. Let's run another simulation with this example. The force now pulls the particle upwards and to the right. It moves in a circle, only it's slanted now in accordance with the new vortex. Let's focus on this tensor. Here are its components. Of course, we're simulating a uniform tensor field, so all these tensors are the same, and they all have the same components. And here are the components of the velocity vector. This is the velocity the particle had when it passed through this point, and this is the force that was mapped to it. Now let's change the coordinate system. These objects have different components now. But these are just different ways of describing the same objects. All these vectors and tensors exist in space and interact with each other independently of any coordinate system. But this simple exercise with rotations doesn't yet demonstrate the advantage of using tensor fields. With the old representation, using a magnetic field, we can also rotate the camera, and everything remains consistent. But with tensor fields, we'll be able to take this principle a big step further, as we'll see in a few minutes. Now let's ask, can we use this tensor to represent electric fields as well? Let's try to have it represent this electric field, pulling towards the z direction. Recall, the electric force is not affected by the particle's velocity. Our tensor should map all possible velocities to the same force. Let's give it a try. We'll fill all rows with the components of the electric field. We got this weird-looking map. The three forces that lie on the axes are certainly the correct electric force now, but practically all the other ones are not. For a large velocity in the x direction, we'll get a larger force. A zero velocity will give us a zero force. And in the opposite direction, we'll get the opposite force. But these are all properties of a linear map. All tensors have these properties. So we seem stuck. But there is a way out. In math, it's common to solve such a problem by adding another dimension. In physics, we have a natural dimension we can add, the time dimension. We'll explain it in detail in the next episode, but here's a sneak peek. A magnetic field still looks basically the same, a vortex. Now let's show an electric field. It's exactly the same map except rotated in space-time. Without a coordinate system, we won't be able to tell them apart.